And so there, like, you can think of the suffering of the lower realms that we studied, giving rise to fear of suffering. This is a low scope kind of refuge, right? So the fear for ourselves of falling into the hell realm, hungry ghost realm, the animal realm. Like, you can also add a kind of a fear that's in accordance with the middle scope, so fearing the suffering is of samsara in general. Of continuing to have and take on aggregates, right, body and mind, conditioned by ignorance and afflictive emotions. Fear of remaining in this vast ocean of suffering. The cause of which is in our own mental continuum, right? Ignorance, grasping at true or independent existence, and all the various afflictive emotions. Afflicted states of mind, hatred, jealousy, pride, desire, and so on. If you like, you can even think of fear as it relates to the great scope, right? So actually it's the same as what we just thought about for ourselves, but then also thinking all others are also subject to that sort of, to these kinds of suffering, suffering lower realms, suffering of samsara in general. Feeling like it's totally unbearable. That all these infinite, precious, sentient creatures are subject to all these different kinds of suffering. It's unbearable that I myself, and that all others, are trapped in ignorance and afflictive emotions, and therefore suffer. I've been suffering since beginning this time. In all kinds of horrific ways. Kind of are in that state of sort of being aware of suffering, fearing suffering, then for refuge practice we think, so who could help? Who can guide me and others to freedom from suffering? So like we've been studying, it starts with contemplating just briefly the qualities of the Buddha. So the Buddha, by definition, is someone who is eliminated all the mental afflictions. So the Buddha has eliminated all of ignorance, all the negative states of mind. Ignorance, desire, attachment, hatred, anger, jealousy, pride, confusion, doubt. And the Buddha has completed the development of all positive, such as compassion, patience, love, wisdom, knowledge. Among teachers, therefore, the Buddha is the best of teachers. Among guides, without suffering, the Buddha is the best of guides. But the qualities of the Buddha's body, the Buddha's speech, the Buddha's mind, the Buddha's activities. So really, as we're kind of afraid of our own and others' suffering and feeling, the Buddha is a valid source of refuge, a valid place to turn. He's using an analogy. The Buddha is like a doctor who can like correctly diagnose and prescribe treatment for our illness of unenlightened suffering existence. The Dharma is like the actual medicine that will cure our suffering. And the Sangha are like the nurses who help us to successfully follow the course of treatment in order to be cured. So now we're feeling like, you know, we're ill with the sickness of samsara. And finally we found the flawless doctor, medicine, and nurses. So with that kind of feeling, then we can take refuge. And so let's go ahead and recite the verse, or the three verses. That's the verse three times. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, to the merits of giving and the other perfections. May I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, to the Dharma, and the Sangha, to the merits of giving and the other perfections. May I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, to the merits of giving and other perfections. May I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. Before we turn to, given what we were just contemplating, before we turn to the text, I wanted to mention something just related to refuge. It's actually from the commentary. I look at different commentaries to this text, and so this one, this point is from, I said something similar, but as long as the Dalai Lama clarified it even more. In this way, as long as the Dalai Lama pointed out that, because we're about to get into this topic, but because one of the points we're about to cover is that the line of becoming a Buddhist, or is the, what does it mean to be a Buddhist? And it says, I think it says in here, the master Shantipa and Atisha say it's taking refuge, right? So there is, if you've taken refuge, you're Buddhist. If you haven't taken refuge, you're not Buddhist. And the Dalai Lama says, you know, sometimes people come to him, or other lamas, like for a ceremony, like the ceremony to take refuge. And it only says, he points out, he says, actually, if the person has taken refuge in their heart already, then they're already Buddhist. And he said, on the other hand, if they come to the ceremony, but they haven't taken, they're not taking refuge in their heart, then even if they participate in the ceremony, they're not Buddhist. And so he says, the main thing is if you take refuge in your heart, then the external, like, sort of taking refuge ceremony with the Lama, as long as he even says, is kind of it's a formality, it's not a bad thing. He says, the main point is if you take refuge in your, from the depths of your heart, in the three jewels. And I thought just to clarify that point too, just in case people don't know. So, what's different actually? That, so, like for taking refuge, the main issue is taking refuge in your heart. Then, if you want to, you can go to a lama or a monk, or, you know, nun, and sort of have a ceremony to take refuge. Some people, if you want, they can give you. In Tibetan tradition, if you ask, they'll give you a Tibetan name. Which matters particularly, but. But the other thing that sometimes happens at that same time, which is different, this you can't just do in your heart, you have to receive from somebody else, is, which we're about to get into, is one thing that in this text that we're in the section we're covering now, it says, is taking refuge is the basis of all vows. So in other words, you can't take Buddhist, any of seven, there are many different vows you can take as a Buddhist. And what it's saying is you can't take any of those vows if you haven't taken refuge first, right? Because you can't take, what's the word? It's silly in a way, right? To say I'm taking vows in the Buddhist tradition, but I'm not Buddhist. That doesn't, so it's not relevant in that sense. So sometimes, like when people take, during the refuge ceremony, sometimes the Lama will then give the Pratimoksha vows. So it's like, and there are, maybe I'll wait, we'll get into that. It's in the text, so I'll explain it when we get to that. We'll get to it today. But so, let's return to the text. So we're on page 74. So these are, we covered already, like what refuge is, and then we covered individual precepts for each of the three jewels, right? We covered that section where it was talking about, like, so with the Buddha, you know, so for example, with the Buddha, to respect even images of the Buddha and so on, and with the Dharma to respect the text, and then the other one, right? The other set was with the Dharma not to harm others and so on, and with the Buddha not to take refuge in other, ultimate refuge in other sources. So those were specific. Now we're covering some general precepts for refuge. And these are quite important, right? Because if you're a practicing Buddhist, then you should know these are like the most basic sort of precepts or advice for practicing Buddhism. So then, I wanted to kind of explain this next part. That sometimes the three jewels, right, or sometimes even if you visualize like a refuge tree, like this tree with all the different Buddhas on it, they call it the field of merit, right? They call it the merit field. You may hear that term. It's in the Lamrim, actually. It says, visualize the merit field. And here, Lama Tsongkhapa uses the same term. He says the three jewels are a merit field, right? And so, I thought you'd just explain, what does that mean? And what he's getting at is this, is that it's a farming metaphor, right? What he's saying is that, what that metaphor is saying is that how do you create good karma, right? How do you create merit? And in general, they say there are two fields of merit through which you can create positive karma. One is enlightened beings, it's like the three jewels, right? And the other is suffering beings. And so how do you create merit in relation to suffering beings is you help, right? You practice compassion. And in that way, you're creating a positive karmic, you know, if you practice love and compassion.
I found the following things.
If others are suffering and you practice love and compassion to them, that's a way of creating merit in relation to suffering beings. Here, Lama Tsongkhapa is talking about how you create merit in relation to enlightened beings. And so what he's saying is, he's pointing out that we finally have this precious human rebirth, right? We finally have met the three jewels. And he's saying it's very easy to create positive karma in relation to them. And so he's saying, don't waste the chance. You know, like, so I'll just go through in order what he says. So he says, what he's saying is like, all happy. Remember, we're going to get more into karma later. But what he's starting to point out here is that all happiness comes from positive karma. And so, and there aren't always, what's going to say this? Like, we don't always have the opportunity to help suffering. Sometimes you do, but many times, like, people don't want your help, or, you know, you try to help and they find you annoying, or you don't know how to help, or, you know, sometimes we try to help but it makes things worse. So it's good to help others, but whereas you have to look for the opportunity to do that. What he's saying is it's really easy to make offerings to the three jewels because all you have to do is do it in your mind. And so he goes through now, we started this last time a little bit, where he says, so the one precept is, he says, it's really easy, whenever you have food or drink, offer first to the Buddha, right? Dharma and Sangha. And he points out, he says, that's a really easy way to create merit, because it's just in your mind, right? You can say a verse, or you can just think, I offer this to the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. And he says, and if you do that, you'll easily create a lot of good karma with very little effort, because you're eating anyway. Right? And I told that story about Lama Tsongkhapa last time, so I won't go into more detail. But then he says, you know, if you're doing this practice of offering food and drink to the three jewels, he says, what you should not do, he quotes a master, Sharawa, he says, what you should not do is, like, don't offer the moldy part of your cheese, He says, if you drink tea, don't like wait till you have the dregs and then say, oh, I'm offering this to the Buddha. No, he says, that's like, obviously that's not a, if you want to create good karma, that's not the way to do it. Right? So you take it when it's still fresh and you offer it, right? And then you can, you know, so he's saying, like, if you have a cup of tea, offer it first to the Buddha, Dharma Sangha, and then drink it. That should be sort of obvious, but he's pointing it out, because sometimes people make that mistake. And then he goes into this metaphor just a little bit more, where he talks about this idea of a field. And what he uses this metaphor, he says, you know, if a farmer has a field, right? And then he's pointing out, he says, and if they forget to plant it one year, right, if they just don't get around to planting their field one year, what's going to happen to their career as a farmer? Actually, I guess in America they would lose their farm. I don't know what happened in Tibet. I guess they starved. But he's saying, and what he's saying is smart farmers will try to use their field all the seasons of the year, right? So they'll plant different, like, fall crops and summer crops and spring crops. And he's saying we should think like that. In other words, like, farmers are trying to figure out how can I use this field the most possible. Right? And he's saying our practice should be like that, that we should think, oh, wow, I have this relationship now, the three jewels. How can I make offerings extensively? And I want to just explain a little bit about that. So that's not just like, you know, so one is like offering the first portion of your food. But part of what Lama Tsongkhapa is getting at here is that it's really easy to create merit in this sense, if you know how to do it. Because if we don't know how to create good karma, it's difficult to. If you know how, then it's easy. And for an example, like, so, because there are both physical offerings and mental offerings, right? So physical offerings means you set up offerings, right? Which we're about to get into, and then mental offerings, you imagine them. And so even if you're, like, tired after work, you can just, like, you can, what's the word? Lay on the couch, and instead of thinking about, what's the word? Things that annoy you, like, you can think about, like, offering, you can imagine extensive offerings to three jewels, and in that way you're creating merit. So he's pointing out, like, what he's saying, like, use that field all the time. What he's getting at is that, like, you don't have to, you know, if you have an altar, of course it's great. You can set up lights and other things. But he's saying even if you're on the metro, right? Like, you can, if you want to, you could be thinking of, like, of making extensive offerings to the Buddha's Dharma Sangha. While you're driving, you can do that. You know, it's not like, you don't need some special external setup to do that. And that's a Dharma practice, is what he's saying. That's one of the practices can engage in. So in that sense, it's quite easy, right? Like, in other words, it really is. You can go be anywhere, you know, like, you can do, and he's saying it's an easy way to create positive karma. So wherever you are, whatever you're doing, if you like, you can just imagine offering to the three jewels. And he says, and if you miss out on doing that while you're alive, it's a heavy loss, right? Because what we were talking about last time, I mean, not last time, but a while ago, you know, once you don't have a precious human rebirth, then you're not able to do. Right now we have this rare opportunity where we can do that. And that's why, like, Lama Zoparam, she often points this out. We don't usually think this way, right? But if you look at it from the point of view of many lifetimes, then, what's the way to say it? Like, it's so rare to have this opportunity where it's easy to create merit. And, like, you know, if you get reborn as a cat, you can't do that. If you're reborn as a dog, you can't visualize offerings to the Buddha. Right? Their brain can't do that. So you have this rare opportunity. So he's saying, if you don't do it now, it's a heavy loss. That's Lama Tsongkhapa's advice to us. And then Lama Tsongkhapa says, so not to have as much regard for the best of fields. So the best of fields is the three jewels, as one has for an ordinary field is not a good attitude. Okay, so I guess if we take it away from farmer, part of what he's getting at is, like, you know, so to say this, like, if you think of an ordinary business person, right? And then, like, actually think about it for a moment. Just think about this. Okay, so ordinary person, like, at work, right? Like, if somebody says, like, let's start with just a worker, right? Somebody who has a job. Right? If somebody says, oh, you can get time and a half if you work some extra hours, right? I'll pay you double, right? Actually, like, people say, oh, sure, I'll do it, right? Like, they don't hesitate, right? Like, I remember, like, my first job, one of my early jobs when I was young, like, the guy was trying to get me to, I had a boss who wanted me to work extra hours, and he said, oh, I'll give you like a, I'll buy you a free dinner at this expensive restaurant. I said, oh, sure, I'll work like half the night. You know, he'll say, I'll pay you, plus I'll give you that. I said, all right, yeah, I'll do it. I was like, you know, like without any hesitation, I said, yeah, I'll give him four or five extra hours. You'll pay me, he was going to pay me, plus give me some extra bonus, basically, right? So without any hesitation, you say yes, right? And then like with business people, if you know people, especially in this Washington area, right? Where people like, if somebody thinks they can get like a contract, right? People stay all night at work. I couldn't help looking at you guys. Right, it's like, you could think it's bad for the employee, actually, but if somebody owns the company, right, then they'll even stay more, actually, right? Like, people work unbelievable, around here, you must know people, right? People work unbelievable numbers of hours, right? 60, 70 hours a week. Like, and, we're taking away from field, because most of the people in this area aren't farmers. But it's actually true, that's what people do, right? And like people are like, well, I wouldn't, you know, how could I miss that, right? It's a $3 million contract, I'm not going to not, I don't care what it takes, I'll work all weekend, right? And what he's saying is like, you know, even if you get the contract or get the boat, like, so I stayed and I worked, like, I got a dinner, so what? Like, it wasn't anything particularly meaningful, right? Or you stay and you get a contract or something. And what he's saying is, if you have that kind of attitude of like not wanting to miss out on a profit, from even some ordinary thing that has not much real, that has no real essence to it, no real meaning. He says, then if you don't think that way about the three jewels, he's being gentle, he says, that's not a good attitude. he's saying that's not smart, right? And therefore he says, therefore strive at all times to make offerings to the three jewels. So I want to point out something, like if you look at Lama, like I'm going to use the example of Lama Zopa Rinpoche. Like, he's always making offerings, right? He's always doing these kinds of practices. So if you watch him, you see that. But actually, like, he's like this. In other words, he's what Lama Tsongkhapa is describing here. You know, and we might think that's strange or something. If we look at it, it's like, oh, why is the person always spending so much time making offerings? But we don't think it's strange when somebody works 60 hours a week, like, you know, and ruins their health, like, to try to make some more money. You know, and then, like, you have that experience, like, actually, like, I'm just laughing. Like, there's what Lama Tsongkhapa is saying here, right? He's like, look at that. I mean, actually, if you look in this area, you see people all the time like that, where they work and work and work, right? They save up money. And then actually, then they're getting old, and then they're thinking, well, I don't know what to do with my money, right? Like, there is now, like, what is the word to say this? Like, especially if their kids have, like, emotional problems or addictions, then they're like, well, I can't even leave it to them. I'm going to die. Like, what do I do with this? Then they become, like, so you exhaust yourself to make money. And then, like, you have the stress of, you know, what do you do with it once you have it? And what he's saying, I'm not against money, obviously, but what he's saying here is, like, we should think about offerings, we should think about creating merit in that way, right? Like, that's something, and what he's getting at is that, actually, a couple of things. One is you don't have to worry about what to do with it because it goes with you when you die, right? So you don't have to, like, create a trust and then, like, have a trustee for your merit. Like, your merit will go with you. Rinpoche used to say, it'll follow after you, and it'll find you in a future life, in this life and also in future lives, right? And merit automatically makes you happy, right? It makes you happy while you're doing it, and it makes you happy when it ripens. Like, the whole process of creating positive karma like that, right? Like, having faith and making offerings. If you think about that, right? So if you're, like, you know, if you're laying down after work, if you get home and then on the one hand, if you're laying there worrying, oh, Maybe it's like I'm going to lose this. Like, the whole process is miserable, right? And the end result is miserable also. And what he's saying here is, like, if you're laying there thinking, oh, wow, I would offer sapphires to the Buddhas, and they would have, like, light shining on them. It'd be brilliant. And there would be, like, diamonds mixed with the sapphires. And I would offer, what kind of food would I offer? I'll offer, like, you know, feasts. Like, what's my favorite food? And I'm like, oh, today I would, like, I was trying this visualization. I really like New York style pizza. And I was like, oh, I'd offer New York style pizza to every monk and every monastery. It was like fun. Like, oh, that'd be fun, a pizza party. Gendon and Sarah, and I don't know, whatever. Like, it's playful, basically. Right? So you're happy as you're doing it, and the result is happy. That's the point. So it's happy at the beginning, middle, and end. And so what he's saying is, you know, if you're intelligent, if you want to practice Dharma, do that. You know, don't spend your time thinking about other things. You know, if you have to, you know, work to survive, fine. But mainly make your mental energy something else. You know, make it Dharma practice. And he's giving an example. He says, it's not, you know, we could think, oh, Dharma practices are difficult. This is easy, right? You could just think, like, I'm offering to the Buddha. You know, what would you offer, right? It's not a hard practice to do. And then he says, I wanted to say something about this next part here. He says, if you do that through the power of the roots of virtue, right, so your good karma, your merit, those will grow in the most excellent of fields. So the most excellent of fields is the three jewels, right? And he says, the power of your intelligence with regard to the stage of the path will increase. So I wanted to say something about this word intelligence here. Because intelligence in this context has a, I misunderstood it early on until Lama's explained to me, so I thought to explain it. Like, in one way they're talking about, he says, like, in one way he's talking about ordinary intelligence, where he says, you know, if you listen to teachings and you can't retain the words, you know, like, that could be an example of lack of intelligence in a sense. Or if you can't understand the meaning when reflecting, or you can't experience it when meditating, you know, then you need to create more merit. But I want to explain, like, there are some, like, sometimes in this context, there will be texts that will say, you know, for the most intelligent disciples, they'll realize this and quickly, and then the medium intelligence will take longer, and the lowest intelligence much longer, and so on. But the main, this is what Lama Tsongkhapa is saying here, is they're not just talking about being smart, right? Like, because later you'll see there's parts where, like, you can be very smart and be unintelligent, according to this point. What Lama Tsongkhapa is saying is, intelligence in this context means having a lot of merit, right? Like, there is being somebody fortunate. They sometimes say the fortunate one. So a fortunate one is somebody who has accumulated, who has been generating a lot of merit. And what they're saying is this, is that if you create a lot of merit and purify your negative karma, then when you sit down to meditate or when you listen to teachings, the meaning will easily dawn in your mind and you'll be able to gain progress. And it's saying otherwise, even if you're like, even if you're intelligent in the worldly sense, like you'd have a high IQ or something, that's not what they're talking about here exactly. It may include a high IQ, but that's not the main point. The main point is, like, that when you hear, contemplate, and meditate on the Dharma, it sinks in and starts to change your heart. Does that make sense? That's what they're talking about, intelligent here. And so, like, when they talk about an intelligent disciple, sometimes in text you'll see, they'll say, like, this teacher was teaching and they found an intelligent disciple. They don't mean like somebody who went to an Ivy League school. You know, what they're talking about there is like that disciple had some kind of ability through the merit they had created, through the positive karma, to progress and to internalize the teachings and to make progress with them. So that's what this is saying. And the other thing it's saying here, so just to be clear then, is if you find yourself unintelligent in that sense, right, if you like you're trying to practice a particular teaching and you can't, it's like you can't really understand it, or you're trying to understand it, you're not. Like, there are two things to do. One is to keep studying, of course. But the other, which we don't usually think of, but this is what Lama Tsongkhapa is advising, is he's saying the other thing to do is to go make offerings, right? To go practice those kinds of practices, and then come back also. So it's not to ignore study, but it's saying you have to do both together to make progress. So that's the Buddhist view. So I just want to say it, because, you know, sometimes people, just say it, like, you'll have that experience, I think. Sometimes you'll try to study some Buddhist topic, and you're just like, I don't know, I don't get it, right? So what Lama Tsongkhapa is saying is the solution to that is keep studying, but also make offerings and do other virtuous practices. Does that make sense, what he's saying? Now he says what I was starting to get at earlier. He says, the offering is not confined to the thing offered. It is confined by your faith. That's interesting, right? And here he gets into an interesting section where he says, two different things here. One is, I'm going to do them in the opposite order. I'm going to say them in the opposite order of what he says. One thing is he says, you know, he points out there's mental offerings and there's physical offerings. So I'm going to say about the physical offerings first, because he says, you know, on the one hand, mental offerings are good. That's sufficient. I mean, it's a good practice. Then he says, if you have material stuff, then you should offer that as well. And what he's saying there is this, it's like he gives an analogy here. He basically says, if you have a lot of physical belongings, but you never make any offerings with those, and you only do mental offerings. He basically says that's like a con man. You know, like, he says, oh, I don't have anything, you know, I don't have anything for you today. You know, like, sort of like, what he's saying is, and then it's and what it's actually doing is then you're just grasping more. You know, it's like keeping your grasping going. And so what he's saying is, first of all, if you have resources, then make some offerings. You know, set up an altar in your house or whatever, or, you know, and actually make offerings physically. And he's saying, don't be lazy about that, right? And, or and then he's saying, but if you, first of all, even if you do that, or also if you don't have the resources, then mental offerings are fine also. Like, so he's saying you should do both. But he's saying, if you have resources, don't only do mental offerings, because that's sort of like, sort of lazy, basically. But then he's saying, if you have faith, and you make mental offerings, then that's quite powerful. And he gives the example of a mandala offering, right? So a mandala offering, he's talking about the set like that, right there. Those three rings, with like it has jewels and things inside. You know, so there's a practice where you have like a plate, and you put like either grains or semi-precious stones or whatever you have. You sort of stack it up, and you visualize offering the universe. And what he's saying here is, you know, if you have faith and you imagine offering the universe, you're creating the karma of offering the universe, you know, things like that. And he says, or water, or, you know, or things you don't own. And what he's getting at there is, like, Gyumen Kensho Rinpoche was talking about this. He said there was a person, one lama who, actually it's a common practice, so when you see something beautiful, right, then you can offer that also to the Buddha, Dharma, and so on. Like, so some people giving examples, like when they're flying and they're coming into a city and you see all those lights, like offering the lights to the Buddha. Or, you know, if you're hiking and you see a beautiful stream, you know, or a beautiful waterfall or something, offering that to Buddha. You know, if you're this time of year, if you're out driving or walking and you see all these flowers, right? You know, right now the magnolias are in bloom. There's what you call those other, the tulips aren't up yet, but the
cherry
blossoms. Are they up yet?
The daffodils.
Daffodils are out. But as you see those different flowers, then he's saying, that would be an example, right? So you offer that to the Buddhas. And that's a practice, right? So you can, see what you're getting at here. Like, this is a way you can integrate practice as you're walking, as you're driving, if you're taking the metro, whatever. Like, you know, you see beautiful things and you offer them to the Buddhas. Does that make sense? So he's talking about different ways of doing practices of offering. So one is visualize, another is using your mandala set, another is if you just see beautiful things out in the world, just offering them to the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. Now, turn to page 75. here he quotes actually this master, Puchungwa, who says, who gives an interesting point that Lama Tsongkhapa says it could be similar. He says this, this Lama, Puchungwa, when he was young, didn't have much of anything. He was very poor. Right? And so he says he would only offer this pungent aromatic plant. So basically, he didn't have anything else to offer, so he would go pick leaves, it sounds like, from some smelling plant, and just burn them. Right? And he would say, that was all he had, so he was offering that. then it says, because he was creating merit, then eventually he was able to gather and he could afford sweet incense. You know, then he kept practicing, and he was eventually able to buy the most fine kinds of incense, the most beautiful. Right? And he kept offering, this was his example, he said, he was noticing that his merit was increasing over time due to his practice. Right? But he kept making offerings. And so what Lama Tsongkhapa is saying here is, you know, even small things, it's good to make offerings. Right? Right? Like, it's good to make offerings even if you only have small things or whatever you have. And that's, like, this is it, the cause for future success. You know, I'll share just a brief story like that. I remember, this is a very, you know, like, whereas we don't usually, I'm just pointing this out, because what he's getting at is karma, right? Lama Tsongkhapa was saying, this Puchungwa was noting his karma was increasing, right? It'd be getting better over time. And, what was that story? Lama Zoparmshe does things like this all the time, there are many things like this, but I remember, like, he had this house, he didn't live there, but, like, somebody offered him a house. I think in California, it must have been that one. And so what is Lama Zoparmshe? So, actually, like, this is very, I'll just go into detail, this is very Lama Zoparmshe. So somebody offers him a house, right? So Lama Zoparmshe thinks, okay, I'll sell the house and give the money to others. So then somehow this person really wants another house, and they said, no, don't sell the house. Like, I'll give you the other money too. Keep the house. So he said, okay, I'll keep the house. So then he keeps the house. So then he thinks, well, I'm not going to live there, right? So he gives it. So he thought, oh, there are a lot of nuns who don't have a place to live. So he created the house as a place for nuns to come live. So then there are nuns living there. So then Lama Zoproche thought, so what do I do with the house? What's the, you know, so now nuns are living there, but like, what's the, how do we make this beneficial, right? So then he set up, like, I visited it. He set up, like, in every room, there are, like, altars with, like, you know, like, here we have 7 water bowls, but there are, like, hundreds of water bowls and lights and tea offerings filling the entire house. So he said, oh, okay, so whoever lives here, that's their, that could be part of their job, is making the offerings extensive. And then, like, he was like, oh, we should build, like, stupas to walk around, and, like, it's called, like, fountains, like, offering to the Buddha. So you'd have, like, a Buddha and a fountain and all that. And a friend of mine said this to me, that he said, after he had done all that, somebody was coming to visit, and he said, oh, when that person sees all these offerings, ask them what they think. And so the person said, okay. So the person came and saw all the offerings, and they said, what do you think? They didn't say Lama Zopa said to ask me. They said, what do you think? And the person said, I think this must be why Lama Zopa is able to help others so much, is he's creating so much merit through doing all these offerings, that then he receives a lot of resources, and that's how he helps people all over the world so much. And Lama Zopa was like, yeah. Like, so it was the same view, right? Whereas, and we think, you know, it's the opposite, right? We think, oftentimes we think, if I want to have enough, I should, like, what's the word? Hold on to what I have. And what Buddhism is saying is, if you want to have enough, be generous. It's not saying give away your house if you're, like, if you don't have a place to live. But it's saying, within, I mean, this is what this is saying, right? Pachungwa, what he's getting at is, within what you have and what you're capable of, practice generosity. Nagarjuna said, right, all wealth comes from being generous. All the karma for wealth comes from being generous. So part of what Lama Tsongkhapa is getting at here is, like, it's not saying, like, hurt yourself or something like that. It's not saying, like, but it's saying, you know, whether it's mentally offering or physically offering, that's the way to create positive karma.
Is it being generous just to the 3 jewels, or is it being generous in all aspects?
All aspects, for sure.
So to other sentient beings, animals.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, and they actually say, like, actually, it's an interesting point. Well, just to pick up even on what you said, like, you know, in other words, I was saying it's easy to make offerings to the 3 jewels because they're always available in a sense. But you know, you can just visualize them. But actually, Gyume Kenshin Rinpoche one day was saying the best offering to the 3 jewels is helping others. You know, he said, like, if you want to, there is, I mean, if there's nobody around, there is, if you're alone in your room, then you can visualize offerings to the 3 jewels, or if you're on the, if you're whatever, driving or something. But Kenshin Rinpoche was pointing out, if you're helping another animal or person or something, he said, actually, that's the most pleasing to the Buddha, because the Buddha's very nature is compassion. You know, so if you want to, I mean, so helping others, you help that person, you also create good karma yourself, and you also, it's like 3 benefits. You know, you help the other being, you also create good karma to help others more, and also you please the Buddhas, because that's actually the best offering to the Buddha, is helping others, because, you know, the Buddha doesn't really need any of this. There's the Buddha accepts the offering sort of as a way of helping you create merit. But the ultimate way to please the Buddhas is to benefit others, essentially. So that's the best offering.
So using your pizza analogy, buying pizza for other people would even be more beneficial than just visualizing giving pizza to all the monks in the world.
Yeah, of course. Exactly. And I guess one thing is, like, the other thing, I guess, is, like, and actually, you know, I'll say one other point about that, which is that, actually, the visualizing practice also is, like, especially for people, let's just say this, like, the one, I mean, this is more, it comes later in the text, but in terms of generosity, one fault we can make, one mistake we can make, is to give, actually, this is an important guideline, is whatever level we're at, we shouldn't give so much that we then, what's the word, like, regret giving, or feel resentful, or something like that. And so, you have to know your own level, in that sense, right? So, in other words, like, and the idea is, as you progress on the path, like, there's actually, I always think this is funny, in some of the guidelines, in Buddhist teachings, they talk about bodhisattvas who are on the first bhumi, they can, like, give away their eyeballs, or give up their life for others. It's the warning. It says, don't try this at home, basically. You know, it's like if you're not at the first, if you're a beginner, don't do this, basically. You know, or same thing. Like, you know, I've met people like that who, like, they met Buddhism, they went like, oh, I love this, and they gave up their house, and it's like, then they regret it. Like, it's like, no, don't do that. You know, like, there is, that's not the idea. The idea is to give at the level where you're happy to give, right, and where you feel glad to give. And if you're progressing, then that should become more over time. Does that make sense? But don't give so much that you're going to regret it afterwards. That's a mistake. You know? And so to me, that's part of the benefit of the visualizing practice. It's like training our mind. How do we become bigger in our heart? Not bigger, like in the sense of more important or fatter, or something, but how do we make our heart bigger? That's part of the benefit of the visualizing practices too, is like feeling, what's the word? Inspired, but if you're not yet at the level where you can actually do that, then you can like visualize as a way of training your mind and taking joy in giving. And then eventually you can actually give more, too. So maybe those go together in that sense. It's like training your mind and how to... Because generosity, remember, generosity is a mind... Generosity isn't giving. Generosity is a mind that takes joy in giving. Does that make sense? So if you have generosity, then giving naturally flows from that. But if you give without generosity, that's not... I mean, then you end up usually grasping and feeling some kind of resentment or upset mind or something like that, and that's not helpful. Is that clear? I just want to clarify that.
Hey, Lauren, I got a question about, because I usually, like, you know, sometimes we've heard about, like, making mental offerings and making offerings and like, you know, you hear music and you make that an offering, just like you were saying. But it's usually, like, you know, I would, like, make a mental offering to the guru, you know. So how does that kind of... what's the difference, if there is any difference, or what's the relationship, what's the connection, or can you elaborate on that, between making an offering to, say, I offer to Jerry Busha, right, and instead of the three jewels?
I guess the, to answer your question, like, actually it's interesting, you know, one, I'll say two different answers. Like, one is, you know, there's a famous, I mean, there are many famous verses, actually. Like, one is the Lama is the Buddha, you know, Guru. The Lama, the Guru is the Buddha, Guru is Dharma, Guru is Sangha also. Guru is the originator of all happiness, all gurus that make us offering. You know, so in one sense, like, that's... there's a line in the Lama Chopa, right? It says, we're looking at our Guru, right? And we say, you are our Guru, you are our Yidam, you are the Buddha, the Dharma. You know, there are these verses like that, right? The, I was actually combining, there's that verse, and there's the planting the stake prayer, right? Where it goes through... You're saying to the Guru, you're the Buddha, you're the Dharma, you're the Sangha, you're the Bodhisattvas, you're the Arhats, you're the Prajika Buddhas, you're the Protectors, you're the Dakinis, you're the, you know, all of that, right? So, in one sense, of course, if you practice Guru Yoga, right, or the Guru training from the Lamrim that we've done, right, then you think, you're actually training your mind to view your Guru as the embodiment of the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. And so then, and then in that sense, you remember, in the Lam Rim section, if you remember, the first part, I mean, in terms of mental training in relation to the Guru, right, it says first view the Guru as the Buddha. There's viewing the Guru as Vajradhara, essentially. Mm-hmm. And the second point is remembering the kindness, right, that the Guru is even more kind than Shakyamuni Buddha, not because he has more compassion from his own side or her own side, but because Shakyamuni Buddha came and went, I didn't get to meet him. But the Guru is the one who gives... who guides us personally. Mm-hmm. And so the sense of like that deep relationship. So one answer would be, you know, when you make offerings to the Guru, because of that training from the Lam Rim, in that sense, you know, it's the same. In other words, you're making offerings to the Guru is the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. So you're making offerings to the three jewels. And then another point that they say is that, actually, Lama Zobrimshe's advice is, even if you're making offerings, like, let's say you're thinking I'm making offerings to the Medicine Buddha or something, then you would think, who's inseparable from my Guru, you know, or something like that. And there's a verse, I think it's in a, actually, I think it's from a teaching on Guhya Samaja, where, I think so, I'm not sure, but, where it says, like, something like, I can't remember the exact words, but basically it says, if I prostrate, whenever I prostrate, I only prostrate to my Guru. Whenever I make offerings, I only make offerings to my Guru. That doesn't mean, like, I don't make offerings to the Buddha. What it means is I see the Buddha as inseparable from my Guru. I see the Dharma as inseparable from my Guru. You know, it doesn't mean like that person would never make offerings to the Buddha, of course, that's silly, but mm-hmm. It's right. That they always view all the enlightened beings as inseparable from their Guru, And they say that's the best practice, actually. Because, you know, in terms of fields of merit, the last thing I'll say about this is what Lama Zorpoche says is, like, there are different, like, sort of, like, you know, actually we'll get into more in the teaching on karma, but there are different, like, the, due to our relationships, different beings have different karmic power in relation to us. And a typical example of that is, like, if you make offerings to, like, somebody on the street versus to your a parent who raised you, let's say your parent raised you very kindly and you helped them, because of, there is, either one's a positive karma, but because of the relationship of their parents raising you and helping you, helping them back has more karmic power, in a sense, is what the teaching of karma said. Or harming your parents has more karmic power than harming a stranger. You know. And then they go up, Lama Zorpoche often explains this, and it's in the teachings, where you can go up, like, more, you know, like, so then there's the an arhat has more power than an ordinary person, a bodhisattva is more karmic power than an arhat, a Buddha has more karmic. But then they say the guru is the most powerful karmic object, because they represent all the Buddhas for oneself, not like from their own side necessarily, but from one's own relationship. Same way, like the parent, not everybody's near. The person's your parent, that doesn't mean that everybody's parent, right? It's just your parent. So whoever your teacher is, because they represent all the Buddhas to you, they say that's the most powerful karma. So in that sense, the best practice is to think, when offering, this is my guru. I'm offering it to my guru, who's the embodiment of the Buddha. Mm-hmm. So that's the best version of the merit field, actually. Is that...
Yeah, thanks.
Other comments? Then Lama Tsongkhapa makes another point, which is, he makes a point that some people, actually, and you, sometimes you meet people like this, like, actually, you know, so it's not far-fetched, like, he's making the point that sometimes you'll hear people sort of say, like, oh, I don't need to make offerings, I'm past that, or I'm practicing, sort of like, some more advanced, like, I'm doing Mahamudra, or Dzogchen, or emptiness, or, you know, some, like, I don't need to do that. And what Lama Tsongkhapa says, he points out, he says, the great bodhisattvas, which means bodhisattvas who are abiding on the bhumis, right? Remember we talked about those, like the 10 bhumis that go, so they're quite extremely advanced levels where they can emanate many bodies and they can visit Buddha realms and so on. And he says, even those great bodhisattvas emanate hundreds of thousands of bodies with hundreds of thousands of arms to make offerings. And then he says, so if you say, oh, I don't need to do that, he says, like, then that's sort of a, he says it's the idle talk of people who have very little familiarity with Dharma. So he's saying, you know, that's, what's the word? Sort of, you don't know what you're talking about, basically. He's saying, you know, whatever level we're at, until Buddhahood, making offerings is part of the practice of bodhisattvas. And actually, it's quite true. If you read, like, in the sutra, I was just reading it recently, like, there's a sutra of, that describes, for example, Samantabhadra, you know, who's a 10th level bodhisattva. Right? He was abiding on the 10th bhumi, which is the bhumi right before Buddhahood. And it describes, like, he's visionary, amazing, like, where he, like, he particularly is famous, where he would sort of emanate bodies, and then those would emanate, he would emanate out, like, from every pore a body, and those from every their pore would emanate a body, and from those every pore, and then he would, like, fill all the space with these bodies, and then he would make offerings to all the Buddhas and bodhisattvas. Which only a bodhi, you know, because he was on the 10th bodhisattva level, he was capable of doing this sort of visionary thing. And so, that'd be an example, right? So Lama was saying, well, if a 10th bhumi bodhisattva, Arya Samantabhadra, is doing that, but you say, oh, I don't need to make water bowls, I'm like, you know, because sometimes people say that, like, oh, I'm too high for that, I won't set up my thing. And he's saying that's idle talk of somebody who doesn't know about that practice. So don't think we're not supposed to think we're, like, past that or something, or beyond, we're higher than that. And then he says, and actually, I'll just point out, like, if you actually check, like, actually, I'll just make another comment on that. Like, I'm going to say this, like, you know, these simple practices, right, like making prostrations or making offerings, like, if you look at, first of all, like, you know, even, like, just to say it, like, high lamas, right, they still sweep their own meditation room every day, you know, and then they set out their own offerings, and they make their prostrations. I remember watching Lama Zorpoche after his stroke, right, where it was like, I mean, his left side, or his left, which side, I can't remember, the left side, I think. But he couldn't, you know, it was so hard for him to do things. And you could see he was making this huge effort to do prostrations. There's like people that, you know, it's like, and he was even like, what's the, it would take him a long time to make one prostration, but he would still do that, you know. Or Gyume Kenzo Rinpoche, I was noticing, he's like, I don't know, I think he's 79 maybe, or 80, I'm not sure which, but, and he still does, he was still, like, sometimes he would stay with me, but he's still doing 100 prostrations every morning. You know, and so then again, like, and then I think, well, I'm like, oh, my back hurts. I don't know if I can, you know, I have back pain. I'm not sure I can do, you know, do that. And then I think, he's seven, you know, he's almost 80, and he's still doing them. Or Lama's Rinpoche had a stroke. There's nothing, I mean, the effort he went through to make a prostration, or to make an offering, right? I mean, with one hand isn't working well, but still he wanted to make the offerings. And then again, like, then I felt like, and if I'm like, I'm kind of tired tonight, or, you know, I don't know, I don't want to get up early and do that. It's like, I'm just saying, like, you know, it's kind of similar to what Lama Tsongkhapa is saying here, right? Like, there is, these are great masters, and you see the effort they go through. And to me, it's partly they've realized this point, and also they're trying to set an example. They're also, not trying to, they are setting an example of how one practices. So again, like, if we think, oh, I'm too tired because I have to work really hard, you know, then that's something's, that he's, what would Lama Tsongkhapa say? That our attitude is a little confused. And then ending this section, Lama Tsongkhapa says, in the sutra collections, you should study what are very vast offerings and honors, and from the bottom of your heart, dedicate them to its supreme extraordinary attitude to the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. And so what that's getting at is, like, like, for example, this Samantabhadra, there are prayers. Actually, we've read it at the center sometimes. So there's a prayer called the Prayer of Good Conduct, or the King of Prayers, it's sometimes called. So you can read prayers like that that are written, exactly, that one was composed by Samantabhadra himself. And so you can read these kinds of prayers and sort of engage, what's it say, engage in these kinds of vast offerings by doing those kinds of practices. So you kind of get a flavor for what great bodhisattvas do. And we sort of emulate, the idea is to emulate their practice. Does that make sense? You know, and also the more you can do the physical offerings, the better. I don't know if anybody was here. Like, we did, last year we did that. Wilhelmina came, and she and I together kind of led our, where we did, like, many of those, maybe more than 1,000 water bowls. You know, we did it at the center. And I was just saying, it's really fun, actually. Like, it's fun to do those kind of practices of making extensive offerings. I remember, like, I'm just giving you examples, like, of the extensive offering. I remember, like, sometimes there's a practice of sur, where you offer, like, some scent, like this scented flower. And so usually, like, people would offer, like, a little, you put a little charcoal and you put a little bit on it. I remember when Lama Tsongkhapa was at my house, I had, like, a, you know, one of those barbecues like that. You put the whole thing filled with, like, barbecue, you know, like, what's it called? Charcoal. And it was like, he was, like, pouring the flour and it was filling the entire neighborhood, you know. The idea is that when making offerings, is the more, again, like, not, on the one hand, not to do so much you resent it, but on the other hand, two things. One is it's fun. Actually, it should be enjoyable practice. If you really get into making offerings, it's a really fun practice to make. And it's fun to do them both physically and mentally. It's fun to, like, even, you know, it's the same thing with helping others, right? Like, I would say, right, like, sometimes people view that, like, you know, you can view it as a chore, but that's not generosity. Do you mind if I share a personal, just a very brief personal example? Like, for me personally, when I try to get into, like, I remember, well, no, it's clear, but I was trying to understand, like, what that mental state was, and it made me think back to when I was a kid. And for me, this is how I first understood what generosity really was. As I remember, as a kid, I was very close with my grandfather, and when I would go visit him, so this is an example for me. He would find an old abandoned house. And he would, he had studied, like, he had gone to classes for magic or something, so it was fun to him. So he would go to the house before I got there, and he would tie strings, like little, what do you call those, fishing line, to different objects in different parts of the house, and then run them somewhere, in, like, some abandoned place in New York City. And then he would tell me the house was haunted. And then we would go there, and we'd walk in, and he'd say, "Stand behind me," and he'd have a stick. He'd say, "I'll beat off the ghost." I was a little kid, it didn't occur to me that sticks don't really help with ghosts. I was like, okay, all right, I'll stand behind you, you got this thing. And he would pull the little thing and something would come flying down the stairs, you know, and I would leap on him and hold on, and he would say, "Oh, I'm protecting you, don't worry." And I remember back, and I was like, the effort he put into that, like, he put a lot of time in, you know, to go there and, like, find candelabras to run a fishing line. He put a lot of effort in, but it was clear he was getting as much joy out of it, more joy probably than, I don't know who got more joy out of him or me. Like, we both really enjoyed those moments. And he would do the same thing in his garage sometimes with me and my sister. But my point is like, I remember thinking back to that and being like, oh, that's generosity, right? Whereas, like, I should say it, like, you're having fun, right? And it's like, and like, you're thinking, what would bring the most joy to this person? And what will really make them happy? And play, and what, like, and it's a playful attitude, and it's a fun attitude, right? And even if you're helping people with, you know what I mean, like, whatever you're doing for others, like, let's just say it, it's with that kind of attitude, the feeling that I remember between us, I was like, well, that's, you know, I'm just giving a simple example, but that's generosity, right? It's a feeling where you feel just as happy, like, you feel honored to get to do this, and you feel just as lucky to get to do it as the other person gets, feels receiving it. So whether you're offering to the three jewels or you're offering to another person, it should be with that kind of feeling in your heart. Does that make sense? Like, where you're like, oh, like, this is great. I get to do this. You know what I mean? And like, when you see the monks making, these are images of them, but when you, like, you know, when they make offerings, they make these, like, ornate butter sculptures, right? Like, with different colors and, like, beautiful designs made of different colored butter and flour and food coloring. And if you watch them making those, it's like, it's fun, basically, you know? And like, they're making these beautiful things, then they throw them away the next day, right? Why are they doing it? It's because it's fun, right? It's beautiful. It's like, as we say, it's like a work of art, you know what I mean? Like, the way an artist, like, why does an artist do what they do, you know? It's because that's, like, that's generosity too, if it's a good art, yeah, if it's an artist who's doing it from that point of view. Like, it's being human, right? It's like the best thing about being human is that we can give. I don't know, it's one of the best things about being human. So anyway, I'm just elaborating a little bit on this point. So if you think, like, oh, I have to make water bowls, then, like, that's not the point, right? It should be like, oh, how cool, you know what I mean? Like, this is fun, and find a way to make it that, to make it inspiring. That's ideally what it should be. So it's just a personal sort of aside to make it more clear. Like, then, and that's why then you make a lot of, you know, when a person feels that way, then they want to keep making expensive offerings, and it's fun, and it's part of their, let's just say it, like, you know, like, why do poets write poems? Right? Like, it's not like they have to. It should be like that kind of feeling. Okay, then Lama Tsongkhapa makes another point. He says, remembering, you know, compassion for others and the benefits of refuge, he says, out of mercy, so out of compassion, establish other sentient beings in taking refuge as much as you can. Just a quick commentary on that point. Of course, Buddhists are, it was an interesting point. I mean, the one he says that, on the other hand, Buddhists are not missionaries, right? Like, there's not a tradition in Buddhism of trying to get other people to be Buddhist. That's not Buddhist. That's not part of Buddhist culture, or something like that. And you know, if you, I'll be honest. I mean, one thing I really find I've always found very touching and inspiring about his Holiness the Dalai Lama is he comes to the West, right? And he says, he's the only religious leader I've ever heard. Like, he's like, he comes to the West and he has like thousands of people, and he says, "Don't become Buddhist, please don't become Buddhist." Right? And then he says, he gives those examples, right? He always tells those stories, like, where he talks about, what was the one? There was one Tibetan lady where the Christian missionaries helped her, and then she became Christian, and then she went to the Dalai Lama and she said, "I felt, you know, they helped me so much with my, you know, with food and clothing or something. I felt I had to become Christian, but don't worry, I'll be Buddhist my next life." And Lama laughs and says, "Now she's not a good Christian or a Buddhist." You know, he's like, if you're a Christian, you shouldn't be believing that you can have a next life where you can become Buddhist. You know, so he says, oftentimes it leads to confusion, right? And he says, so with us Westerners, oftentimes he says, I discourage you, but he says then, like, if you really want to and you feel deeply inspired, and it's like, you know, then it's okay, you know, kind of, but I'm not encouraging it, and take your time and try to see if you can avoid it, basically. Mm-hmm. It's fun. Try to avoid becoming Buddhist, but if you can't help it, then it's okay.
But isn't this saying that you should try to encourage?
Yeah, so it's a little tricky is what I was getting at. Like, yeah. So I was contrasting what the Dalai Lama's message is at this point. So the way I take this one, I'll just say, it's not really clear. So I was thinking, oh, how do you make sense of that, right? That he's, and here Lama Tsongkhapa is saying, encourage others to become Buddhist. Whereas the actual Buddhist tradition...
Every time I've ever seen him, he's always made that, at some point, even in an hour talk in the public, he always says it.
Don't become a Buddhist.
Yeah.
Me too, I've heard that so many times. The way I personally take this, I'm not sure exactly, I don't know Lama Tsongkhapa's exact intent, but the way I take this is two things. One is, if somebody's interested in Buddhism, then of course, explain it to them. I think the other, though, is even the one thing, you know, is to also to explain the correct practice of. That if somebody is already Buddhist, is sort of already culturally Buddhist, or is already sort of interested in Buddhism, or is already says they're Buddhist, is also to make, like, is to then help them understand the correct practice of taking refuge. That seems quite appropriate. Because one of the commentaries said, I thought it was quite funny, it said sometimes people who are dressed in robes or something, like as monks, aren't really, they can't be a monk because they haven't taken refuge in their heart, and like that. So there is teaching somebody like that how to take refuge correctly, you know, it's I think part of what Lama Tsongkhapa is saying here is like, and Atisha was doing that a lot, like going around explaining, like people said they were Buddhist, but they didn't really understand what it meant to really be Buddhist. So that, I think that, to me, that's the way I take this first person. Is to make sure, that, you know, is so to help people understand the real meaning of refuge. One commentator, one Geshe who was commenting said, which again is very much in line with Dalai Lama's message, he says, encouraging people to take refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha is not relevant because that's not their tradition. He said, but then, this is not exactly what Lama Tsongkhapa is saying, but his commentary was reminding people of the value of love and compassion, the way he interpreted. At least we can remind everybody of that, because that's universal. I'm just trying to see if there was another thing. Okay, that comes later. Lama Tsongkhapa is saying, whatever you do, whatever you need, worship the three jewels, supplicate them, abandon all worldly methods. So, he gives the example here of the Bun tradition in Tibet, given that Lama Tsongkhapa was writing in Tibet. But what he's saying here is, in all your activities, rely on the three jewels, is one point he makes. And then he says, and don't rely on things that are incompatible. So the commentary, I didn't know what this meant about Buddha, so I looked it up in the commentary, just what he was getting at. And what they're saying is, like, there were some practitioners in Tibet of Buddha, which is a kind of pre-Buddhist shamanistic religion of Tibet. And it was saying there were some practitioners who did things like animal sacrifices and so on, like thinking that they could have success by doing that. And he's saying, if somebody's doing a practice that's incompatible with the three jewels of refuge, then you need to stay away from that. For yourself. And there's, if you've taken refuge and they're saying, oh, you can have success by doing this other thing, but that's, you need to not participate and you need to rely on the three jewels in order to have success. So that's really what he's getting at. Being aware of the benefits, so if you've taken refuge and you're Buddhist, you should do refuge three times a day and three times at night. Does that make sense? So, that's part of the precepts of refuge, is that six times a day you take to actually think about refuge. Then it goes into what I was talking about earlier. So it says the benefits of eight points about the benefits of taking refuge. So one is it's the entryway to Buddhism, right? So he says, if you've not taken refuge, you're not Buddhist. If you have taken refuge, you are Buddhist. And if you take refuge in your heart, and that's where I was making that point. The elder is Atisha. So Atisha and Shantipa, two great Buddhist masters, agreed on this point that the doorway to being Buddhist is refuge, taking refuge in your heart. And he says, from the bottom of your heart to do that is the line of taking refuge. And then this is what I was referring to too. It says, another benefit of taking refuge is that it's the basis of all vows. And so what that means is that in Buddhism, there are different levels or types of vows you can take and precepts you can take. but you can't take them if you haven't taken refuge. And then Lama Tsongkhapa here says, in this, from the 70 verses, he says, Upasakas take refuge in the three. That is the root of the eight vows. So just to clarify what that means, usually they talk about, like, in Tibetan Buddhism, they talk about three sets of vows. So the first set of vows are what this is referring to, the eight vows, which are, in Sanskrit, it's called the pratimoksha vows. And so that's the vows that, that's a set of vows that monk vows are included in. But there are actually eight different levels of pratimoksha vow. And so let's go through what they are, because it's good to know what, at least what the names of them are and what they are. So the first of the eight is a one-day vow. And that's like sometimes they call, similar to what they call, we've done them at the center, the eight Mahayana precepts. So it's eight vows you take for just 24 hours. And that includes, so it's like for 24 hours you make a vow to, it includes, anybody can take these, including lay people. But it's, so it's like for this 24 hours to be celibate, to not eat afternoon, to not sit on high expensive beds or wear ornate jewelry. It's sort of like for 24 hours to really live a very simple life, eating only one meal, sort of living very simply for that day. It's a wonderful practice to do, like sort of to, for retreat purposes or just to increase your mindfulness for a day, to really do a day like that, really be simple. And you take it, you get up early and you take it kind of at dawn, all right, just before dawn, and you keep it until dawn the next day. So that's one set of vows, and that's part of the pratimoksha vows. So you can't do that if you're not Buddhist, in other words. You can't really take those. But if you're a practicing Buddhist and you want to take those, you can. The next two vows are what's referred to, upasika and upasaka, that's what it's called. But so it's male or female layperson vows. And I want to just mention that, because that's where sometimes when people take refuge, then lamas, people go, you know, as if you want to do this, you can, if you haven't already. So, you know, it's like, as a Buddhist layperson, just taking refuge doesn't mean you've taken these vows. So what this is like the vows of, they're like morality vows. And as a Buddhist layperson, there are five, and you can take one, two, three, four, or all five. It's up to you. So one of the vows is not to kill. Another is not to steal. Stealing. Not to lie. Not to commit sexual misconduct. And not to use intoxicants. And so, as a Buddhist layperson, once you've taken refuge in your heart, if you want to take these upasika or upasaka vows, so lay male or female vows, then you can. So that's an opportunity. So you can go to a lama, and you can, you know, and like sometimes as part of a ceremony they'll do it, or, you know, they can do it for you individually if you ask. But if you say, I want to take those vows, that's good. That's a good thing to do. But you should really contemplate deeply for yourself. First of all, do I want to take them? Secondly, will I keep them? Don't take it if you don't want to keep it. And it's up to you how many of those you want to take. Does that make sense? So usually, like, sometimes in big public gatherings, someone says, Dalai Lama will give them, and he'll say, you know, he'll give all five, and he'll say, but you take, you know, the audience, because it's a large audience, take whichever ones each individual wants, and you take those. And that's quite beneficial, you know. So like it's a, and that's sort of the, what's the word to say it, basic level of lifetime vow. And pratimoksha, so it's the same category. So anyway, so that's three, right? The one-day vows, the female lay vows, and the male lay vows, that's three. Then there are two more, the novice monk and nun.
How do the female and male differ? They're the same five, aren't they?
It's the same five. It's just a difference of they have a different term. There is upasaka, upasika. So it was just a different. Let's just say it.
Because in English,
for lay
always,
people, it's
in English, it's always the same. I've always heard the words being used the same.
It's the same vowels. Yeah, they're identical actually for male and female. There's no difference. There is, you can take the same. I mean, and male and female have this. It's the same five, and you can have the same choice. You can take one, two, three, four, five. So there's no difference except the gender of the person taking it. Where there are differences, then the novice monks and nuns, those have monk and nun vows, I don't know them, I've never studied them, I don't know the details, in other words, but the novice monks and nuns, they're slightly different. The male and female have slightly different vows, so I think that's why they categorize gender,
okay.
Is because not for the lay people, because it's the same, but at the monk and nun level, there are differences in the vows.
you actually on the Sangha, it actually does. Sangha actually do have different vows based on gender.
Yeah, they're, I mean, most of them are same, but there are some differences. So there's novice monk and nun. Then I didn't know that there was this. I was just reading in the commentary. Then there's something called a probationary nun, which I'm not sure what that is. Leading up to full ordination, and then there's a fully ordained monk and nun. So that makes eight. I don't know the details. But again, I know that the fully ordained monks and nuns, their vows, there are many that overlap, but there are some that are different. I'm not sure what the differences are. Because only monks and nuns are supposed to study monks and nuns' vows. That's why I don't study.
But for lay people, then, there's really just the one day, and then there's the five.
Yeah. No. So those are, in terms of pratimoksha vows, which are like these individual, usually sometimes translated, individual liberation vows. So it's that level of, that those are the options. You can take one-day vows, and if you receive, one thing I'll say about the one-day vows, they say ideally, you can take them just by visualizing from the Buddha, but it's better if you, the first time you take it with a Lama, if you can, if you get the chance to take it with a Lama, it's good to take it once. But then you can just take it visualizing the Buddha. So anytime you want, you can visualize the Buddha and just take them. There's like verses for taking them, and you say from now until sunrise tomorrow, oh, I got it. You go through these eight. And with those, it's not, with the eight, if you take all eight, you're supposed to take all eight and keep them for 24 hours. It's not long. And then these five, then the male and female can have, either one can take any of the five, or all of the five. And it's quite a good thing to do. So if you haven't ever done that, and you have the opportunity, you can have, sometimes lamas just offer it, but also if somebody's interested, if Kensa Rinpoche comes to the center, or another lama, you can request it. It's okay. It's only take, it's the short ceremony. It's not like a big one day. So if somebody wants to do that, we can do it. But then, and then I'll just declare. So that's the eight pratimoksha vows. Lama Tsongkhapa doesn't specifically mention here, but in the commentary does. Is then they're based on refuge. So you have to have taken refuge first, then you can take these pratimoksha vows, any ones you want. So if you want to become a monk or nun, you can do that too. Then there are the bodhisattva vows. So the bodhisattva vows also depend on having taken refuge. And there are two sets of bodhisattva vows. There are the aspiring bodhisattva vows, which are the first, more basic level. And then there's the engaging bodhisattva vows, which is a lot of different precepts for bodhisattvas. Where you're saying, I'm going to actually engage in the six perfections, essentially. When you take the engaging bodhisattva vows, you're committing to not just wishing to become enlightened, but to actually do the practices of the six perfections as much as you can. And so then there are guidelines in those, in vows. So there are things if somebody's really sick, you can't, and you say, I'm practicing the six perfections, you can't blow them off and say, I'm not helping you. If you have materials that can help somebody and they ask you for help, you can't just say, go away, you try your best to help, and so on. So that's the bodhisattva vows. And then for those who are interested in taking tantra, vajrayana, tantric initiations, then in the two highest classes of tantra, yoga tantra and highest yoga tantra, there are specific tantric vows. And again, those depend on refuge. So what it's saying is you can't take any of those kinds of different vows, or take initiations, or take bodhisattva vows, any of those things without taking refuge first. Does that make sense? Then it says other benefits of taking refuge. So it says, due to having taken refuge, your karmic obscurations are reduced and exhausted. There are a couple things worth saying here. One is just in general through the practice of taking refuge. In other words, if you engage in the practice of refuge throughout your life, taking refuge from your heart, naturally your negative karma will be reduced, is one thing it's saying. And then here it says it here and in another point, but I'll say it here because they give the example. Here they give an example of, Lama Tsongkhapa gives a traditional example here of, he calls it, there was somebody in the god realm, right? It says the son of a god. It actually means the Devaputra. It's a Sanskrit word. So it means like, there was a being in the god realm, right? And the story goes that this being was in the god realm and they were, when beings are in the god realm, they have this kind of like very pleasurable existence for a period of time, right? And then it's said that ordinarily the being in the god realm has these signs of their upcoming death. So their flower gardens start to wither. And their body, which previously smelled like perfume, starts to have a different kind of unpleasant scent. If you've been around people who are dying, that humans, that's also sometimes true. But they say that the god beings in the god realm have a vision of where they're going to be reborn. So can you imagine, like, this being was in the god realm, right? Where the god realm is like, if you imagine, like, what's the way to say it? You know, it was a desire realm god, right? So it wasn't the form or form of the realm. So desire realm gods, it's kind of like, if you think of, like, the most, what's the word, is it like the most wealthy people on earth, it's like that, only much, much more so, right? So with yachts and, you know, like all that, whatever, mansions. And but it's in this desire realm with God, so it's like more pleasure than that. And so this being had this vision that when he died, he was going to be reborn as a pig. So you can imagine how freaked out that being would have been, right? And it said that a Buddha came and said, take refuge, and that will cure it, you know, that will fix this. And so the being took refuge from his heart, and therefore didn't take rebirth as a pig, but got reborn, I think, as a human or a god again, I'm not sure. I guess as a god again, due to the power of having taken refuge. So I wanted to comment on this a little bit, this point, because in general, during life, it said if you take refuge regularly, then that helps to purify your karma, right? It helps to decrease your affliction. But then there's another thing that's implied by this story that Lama Zoparimshe and Riparimshe pointed out, which is this. This is an important point. So there's this idea, you know, like, where you go in your next life is important, right? According to Buddhism, like our, you know, because next life is often longer than this life. Right? And so the advice that's often given in general, and not just about this point, in general, is you should make a plan, actually. I wanted to sort of, this is, I think, an appropriate point to comment on this. Like, Lama Zoparimshe and Riparimshe used to say it very nicely. He used to say, so you should have a plan for your death time. There was like, because you don't know when death will come, right? You know it's going to come, for sure. And so, like, a plan not in terms of, like, this is not like a trust or a will, I'm talking about that kind of plan, but a plan for your mind, right, like for your karma. Meaning, like, what practices do I want to do at the time of death? You know, like, and like to train your mind so that they're there for you. Does that make sense? Because at the time of death, it's not like the easiest, most peaceful moment, right? Usually people are in a lot of pain. It's confusing. It's frightening. And so if you don't have a plan, it's not like, that's not the time to try to figure out, well, what's my plan going to be. Does that make sense? And then what Riparimshe used to say is, you should, ideally, if you're smart about it, you should have like a, let's say this, like a, I say it right, you didn't use this word, but almost like a tiered plan or a structured plan. And he used to say, because you might have like your idea, like, you know, ideally I would do this, like some advanced practice. And then he would say, he knew a lot of, good practitioners who had died, right? And he said, you know, like when people are healthy, they have some idea, oh, maybe I'll, like, so he would give an example. He would say there are certain, like, very advanced Vajrayana practices, right, tantric practices that involve complicated visualizations and so on. And he used to say, you know, sometimes people say, I want to do that when I die. And then he would say, good. They said, but then he found when the person was, like, actually dying, they were in too much pain and they were, like, they couldn't do it. Right? And so he said, like, have a backup plan. And then have a backup plan for your backup plan. You know, so that was his point. So he was saying, like, so if you have some advanced practice, you say, I'd like to meditate on emptiness as I'm dying. Good. You know, this is, but you better have a backup plan because that's hard to do. You know, and if you check, right, there are many practices where even if we're, like, really healthy and we've just eaten and we're sort of, like, you know, we ate a while ago or something and we're sort of feeling at ease in our body and then we really concentrate, maybe we can do it sort of. Well, death isn't going to be like that, right? Like, you can't eat for days, right? You're sometimes on medications that confuse you. You're pain, your body, your organs are failing, so your brain's not working properly. So Riparimshe would say, have a backup plan, you know, like, you can have as many backup plans as you want. There's no harm in that, right? So you're ready. So he would say, if there's some advanced practice you want to do, great, have that be your first option. But then he said, then have backup plans, you know. And what Riparimshe used to say was, he said, whatever advanced practice you have, like POA, or there are these, like, transference of consciousness practices and so on. say, good, all that's good. But the reality is, it's like you don't really know if you'll be able to do those when the time comes. So you say there are two things, like, let's just say, like, one was, he used to say, tonglen, taking and giving practice. He said, that one won't abandon you. Because even if you're in pain, and you're suffering and so on, you can still take on the suffering of others and give away love. You know? So he used to say, the two practices that won't abandon you, even when you're at your worst, are tonglen and refuge. And he said, and so when you're dying, if you can do those two, then that is transference of consciousness. In other words, you're not going to go to lower realms, you'll go to someplace good. Then you'll be guided by the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, and by your own compassion, if you can do tonglen. And so, so his advice was in accordance with this point, where he was saying, you know, have as many different ideas as you want about what to do. And he said, but his advice was remember tonglen and refuge. Because when the time of death comes and you're in terrible pain, or you're confused, or you're disoriented, or you're starving, or you're whatever, those are two things that if you practice them in this life, then at the time of death, you won't forget them. And you'll still be able to do them, even then. Does that make sense? And actually, maybe I'll just share a personal story about that too. Do you mind? Is that okay? Maybe it's good. I think it's helpful. Because it's related to this point. I was quite impressed by it. This gave me more trust in that. Even that, because like I know high lamas can do that. But I'll share a story about my mom, actually. She's Buddhist, but she's not some great practitioner or something. She's an ordinary person who got interested in Buddhism, and she hasn't done like tons of things like that. But at one point she had like a tumor in her brain, and she had to have a brain surgery. And then after the brain surgery, she fell out of the bed and smashed. So she had just had surgery on her brain, and then she was disoriented because of surgery, and somebody forgot to put the thing up, and she fell, and she banged her head. So she was like in terrible pain, and disoriented, and confused, and all that. And she told me this afterward. I mean, she couldn't speak at that point, but she told me afterwards that she had this experience where she was like terrified, you know, and totally disoriented. She couldn't remember her name, she couldn't remember who she was, she couldn't remember anything. And she was terrified, and she said, just what Reverb Shade was, she said, all she could remember was, she like for a long time she was afraid, and then she remembered to take refuge in the Dalai Lama and to do tonglen. And she couldn't remember her own name, she couldn't remember if she had children or not, she couldn't remember any of that, but somehow she could remember the Dalai Lama to take refuge, and she could remember tonglen. And she said immediately all of her fear went away, and she felt peaceful, and she felt unafraid, and she just like felt protected because she felt compassion. Right? The Dalai Lama to her represented correctly compassion, and tonglen was a, and she said immediately she felt safe. The pain didn't go away, and the disorientation didn't go away for a long time, but immediately like all that fear went away, and she felt a sense of that she was protected, you know, by her own compassion and by the Dalai Lama's. By the memory of the Dalai Lama. And so my point is like, I remember when she told me that story, I thought, oh, this is really true. In other words, that if you do those things in your life, they really don't abandon you. Like, because if she could remember her own name, but she can remember that, I thought, okay, that really works. You know, Rinpoche was right. You know. So I'm just sharing that to say, you know, for us, like, we don't have to be some, we may not be some great practitioner or some yogi or something like that. But if you take those practices to heart in this life, they will help you. And that's, you know, like, you know, Rinpoche used to say that, but when I saw it happen to her, I was like, okay, really, that's true. Like, then anybody can do it if you try. Does that make sense? So you should I advise that though. Make a plan. Make your like sort of death time plan for yourself. You know, whatever that would be for you. I have some friends actually who have done that, and then they've asked me to help, you know, sometimes, like, oh, can you be there? There were also friends of mine who are quite a bit older than me, said, you know, I don't know, I'll still be alive either, but they said, if you're still alive, will you be there? And I should say, last summer I went to visit a friend of mine where we had that kind of agreement, and he said, you know, I was going to see him in the summer, and he said, can we do a dry run? So, like, you know, I said, sure. So he said, like, all right, so, you know, so his wife was there, and said, okay, so, you know, all right, so let's go through it. So I'm dying, and what's the, you know, he had certain practices he wants to do. And so we actually went through it together. So, you know, and it was very touching, I mean, for his wife and for me and for him, because I love him very much. But it was like, okay, this is our practice run. Next time we do this, you'll be dying. You know, it's like, next time we go through this, it's for, the, you know, that's the point. In other words, And it was very touching to do that, but beautiful, you know, like this idea of, he was to say, like, for him, it was this idea of really being ready and therefore being less afraid also. Does that make sense? Like, so I just think, I'm just saying, it's really a wonderful thing to do. And then it says, next point is, by taking refuge, you accumulate vast merit. And then he says, Lama Tsongkhapa says, if it were to take shape, right, if your merit, if the merit of taking refuge were to take a form, first he says the three realms would be as small as a vessel. So what he's saying is, like, basically there you could say it this way, the Milky Way wouldn't be big enough to fit the merit from taking refuge. And then he says the great oceans, you know, so he's giving examples, right? He's saying, he's trying to say, like, on a human, he's trying to give some metaphor. So he's saying, imagine when you're standing looking, you know, when you're standing at the edge of the beach and you're looking out at the ocean and it looks infinite? He's saying, that's not big enough for the merit. Or he's saying, when you're standing there at night, you know, you look up at the sky, at the Milky Way, right, and at all the stars, he's saying that wouldn't be big enough to hold the merit you'll create. So he's giving like a human way to try to get a sense, he's using a spatial metaphor. You know, so you think of that experience, right, of looking at the ocean or looking at the sky, and he's saying, if you take refuge in your heart, you create more, the merit, the good karma you're creating is more than that. Does that make sense? So he's using analogies. And then he says, you won't fall into lower realms, right, but we just went over that. If you take refuge, you won't fall into lower realms. Then he says also, you won't be harmed by humans or non-human obstacles. And what he's getting at there, just elaborate just a little, is they're talking about, like, so he's talking about, for example, like, non-human obstacles. What he's talking about there, really, I think they're talking about spirits. Like, the spirits won't harm you if you take refuge.
He says this is easy to understand.
Yeah, but for us, maybe it's not so easy. That's why I thought I'd say a couple words. Actually, I'm going to combine this one. So he's saying, you know, spirits won't harm you if you take... And actually, the Dalai Lama points this out. He says... The Dalai Lama sometimes is critical of Tibetan culture in this way, in a way I quite like, where he points out that, like, sometimes Tibetans rely too much on, like, protector spirits or something like that. Right? The Dalai Lama is quite critical of that and says, you know, the real protector is the Buddha, right? You know, represented by the statue. And he says, so, you know, if you're afraid or of harm from non-human entities or spirits or something or whatever, he's saying, like, if your main reliance is on some spirit protector, that's a mistake. Your main reliance should be on the Buddha, because if you're Buddhist, you know that we've already talked about the qualities of Buddha. So he's saying that should be your reliance. And then he says, you will attain everything you wish. And then he says, to explain that, he says, whatever Dharma activity you do, if at the beginning you make offerings to the three jewels and take refuge in them and supplicate them, it will be easily accomplished. And also you will swiftly achieve Buddhahood. So I just wanted to make a comment on this one, too. Like, what this is saying, in a sense, is especially when you're doing, like, some kind of spiritual practice or undertaking a project of some kind or whatever, what it's getting at is that part of the practice of being Buddhist is to take refuge in the three jewels and make offerings and sort of ask for their assistance or something like that. And I wanted to make a comment, particularly in, I mean, you can just do it to Shakyamuni Buddha, and that's totally fine. But I wanted to just make a sort of elaboration on this for a moment, because in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, there's also a practice related to this, or a kind of positive, a very wonderful tradition or something, which is, you know, like, sometimes you'll see, and I just thought to explain, because people, you know, center, just to say this, like, you know, there are a lot of different Buddhas and Bodhisattvas in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, right? Whereas there are some other traditions that don't have as much elaboration of imagery, and that you can see in the center, there's no shortage of imagery in Tibetan Buddhism, right? And if you go to any Tibetan Buddhist center, there's a lot of different imagery. And part of that is related to this, in a sense that, let's just say this, like, if you look at how, like, Tibetan, you know, Indo-Tibetan Buddhists practice oftentimes, there's a tendency which is quite nice, which is like to rely always on Shakyamuni Buddha to some extent, but also on other Buddhas for different purposes. That's my point. And so that's related to this point here where he says, at the beginning of any Dharma activity, take refuge and make offerings and rely on the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. So, for example, you know, like you'll see at the center sometimes it's done like medicine Buddha puja. I'm just giving examples, right? So that's pointing out, like, in other words, if you're trying to help people, like, so if somebody were starting medical school, or if you have a relative who's sick, right? Like, it's a great comfort, to be honest. I mean, I remember, more personal story, but I think it's okay because it's directly related to the story. I remember, like, when my dad was dying in hospice, it was great to have the medicine Buddha practice and to just sit with him and do that. You know, and sort of, it gave a way of being present that was quite beautiful. And he really, I remember him really feeling it. And even saying he wasn't afraid to die because he felt, he wasn't Buddhist even, but he just felt the connection to that energy. And so my point is like, you know, whether you're trying to help a relative who's sick or whether, like the 21 Taras here, green Tara, you know, let's just say it, like when Tibetan Buddhists oftentimes, and Buddhist practitioners oftentimes will rely on Tara when, you know, if you're trying to do some project to benefit others, right, to say, Tara, please help. You know, like, in other words, you know, because it's a Dharma activity, right? Whatever Dharma activity. So, you know, it's not to like, it's not Dharma practice to ask Tara to help you win the lottery, because that's not the idea. You know, the idea is if you're trying to do something to help other beings, then first you should take refuge and rely on Buddhism. So you can rely always on Shakyamuni Buddha, that's fine. But there's a tradition like, so, as we say, of relying on different Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, right? So like medicine. You know, so you'll see at the center, some of these people would be doing Tara practice, medicine Buddha practice, or Maitreya practice, or different practices. So it's just because different Buddhas and Bodhisattvas have different, what's the word, say this? Like, so I'll give an example. Like recently in California, for California, Lama Zopa Rinpoche advised doing, and people were doing a lot of it, this practice of, there's a Bodhisattva called Shidigarbha, which means the earth store Bodhisattva. So he's a Bodhisattva very connected to the earth. And so there was a risk of like people being harmed by earthquakes. So Lama Zopa Rinpoche said, do practices of the earth store Bodhisattva to sort of pacify the energy of the earth in that area. You know, so I'm just saying there are different Buddhas and Bodhisattvas who have different karmic vows and different connections. And so part of this practice of relying and taking refuge can be relying on different Buddhas and Bodhisattvas for different purposes. Does that make sense? Kind of like, and so you can learn about those. And that's why sometimes people take different, like, take on different practices. It's like there's a feeling of connect. You know, like, you know, so if somebody's, like, if somebody's, trying to help the sick a lot, it might be good to do medicine Buddha. Tibetan doctors often do rely a lot on medicine Buddha practice, for example. Well, that makes sense, right? Because they're trying to connect, they're trying to take refuge in the medicine Buddha, and he made particular vows to help beings who are suffering from illness. So anyway, that's part of that practice of taking refuge. And also I'll say one more point about that. Also, for different people, I've just noticed this over time, different people also have like different, they connect, they have a different karmic connection to a different, some different Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. Sometimes for different purposes, and sometimes just that person has that connection. You know what I mean? So there can be a great benefit then, and sort of, that can be a version though of taking refuge in the Buddha, is that, and the Dharma and the Sangha, is sort of doing that, you know. And I was thinking of another example, like, in the monasteries, you'll see when the monks are having a hard time, or when they're beginning their studies, or having a, beginning to enter into difficult topics, they'll rely a lot on Manjushri, like the Buddha of wisdom. You know, and that makes sense, right? Because they're trying to get help for their wisdom. So they take before they begin studying some new text, they go and take refuge in Manjushri and do some offerings and prayers to Manjushri, and then they go study. You know, so that's examples of how this could be done in daily life. Does that make sense? Then the next point Lama Tsongkhapa says is, another benefit of taking refuge is you will swiftly attain Buddhahood. and so he says, you know, again, he's saying take refuge three times a day, three times at night. And part of this is like, so if you take refuge, you won't fall in lower realms. You can, it'll help you to continue getting good rebirths and continue practicing the path in order to quickly achieve Buddhahood. So that's another benefit of taking refuge. Maybe we'll finish the refuge section today. I'll just keep going. Next, he gives an advice. He says, don't give up on the three jewels of refuge, even for the sake of your life or for a laugh. Right? So what he's saying there is like, okay. There, what he's saying is, two things, right? He's saying one is just because, like, actually, the, you know, say, well, when would that happen? But actually, it just happened in, the, in our lifetimes in Tibet. Right? People in Tibet, where they were, let's sort of say, the communist Chinese army sometimes would say, you have to renounce the three jewels, you know, and the Dalai Lama, and Tibet, and Buddhism, or I'll kill you, right? And so, you know, that's an example of this circumstance, right? And there were many monks who, and nuns who said, no, I won't renounce, and they were killed. So that would be a real example of that. And then he's saying, if you think of that example, then it's easier to get to the second one, right? He's saying, it's also not something to joke about, right? Like if you want to make jokes, don't joke about giving up on the truth. Like, that's not a topic for joking around or something like that. It's a spiritually serious subject. So he's saying that's not, you know, don't utter those kinds of words as part of a joke. This is Lama Tsongkhapa's advice. And then Lama Tsongkhapa clarifies four points of that are sometimes confusing. And this is the end of the refuge section. So one point is, he says, some former Tibetan teachers have said that you should take refuge. There, in Vajrayana Buddhism, there is like a Buddhas of different directions. Actually, I guess that's also true with even non-Vajrayana. So like, for example, they often say Amitabha's Sukhavati Pure Land is the Western paradise in the West, right? So he's saying some lamas in the past have said, you know, so if you're going west, you should take refuge in Amitabha. And if you're going, east would be Vairochana, I think. There are different Buddhas of different directions. They change sometimes depending on the lama. So it's a little. But he's saying, I don't know a source for that. He's saying some lamas have said, do that practice. And then Lama Tsongkhapa says, I haven't seen a source for that. So he's saying, he's just clarifying that. He's saying, some lamas say to do that, but I haven't seen any particular source in the texts to advise that, so I don't think it's necessary. That's basically his point. Then he says, about these precepts we've just covered, he's going over what are the sources for those. Just to make it clear, and this is important, you may say, well, why is he saying that? But the reason he's saying that is Lama Tsongkhapa really is emphasizing an important point here, which is he's not making this up, right? There is, just because he's a Lama Tsongkhapa, this great teacher, he doesn't just make up stuff, right? Whereas everything he's teaching comes from valid previous, if it's Buddhism, it should come from a source going back to the Buddha, right? Being traced back. And that, it's an important point, so we shouldn't make stuff up, you know, like in a, and we shouldn't rely on teaching. This is part of the practice of refuge, actually, right? Because if you're relying on the Buddha, then you shouldn't rely on a teacher who just makes up something of their own, right? You should rely on teachers whose teachings accord with what the Buddha taught. Does that make sense? So it's actually a very deep, you know, it could seem like, well, why is he even bothering to say that, right? It's like a footnote almost or something. But it's actually quite deep in a way, right? Because he's saying, you get my point there? He's saying, we're talking about refuge here, right? So we're talking about refuge, and that means in the Buddha, then the teaching should be Buddhist, right? And all through this text, he makes reference to previous, he often quotes Indian sources. These are all Indian sources. Because he's saying, we, you know, he's basically saying, he himself and we Tibetans or whoever, we shouldn't make something up. Buddhism should trace back to the Buddha. And so what he's saying is, the six common precepts, right? Those are the six that apply to all the three jewels. Come from Atisha's commentary on the difficult points of Lamp for the Path. So the early Lamrim. Lamp for the Path was the first text that's formerly a kind of Lamrim genre. And then Atisha wrote his own commentary to it. And so what he's saying is those six come from that source. So he took them from there. And then among the uncommon, the specific precepts, right? The precepts of the Buddha, Dharma, Sangha, he's saying the first three. So the first three were, if you take refuge in the Buddha, don't take refuge in mundane refuges, like worldly spirits or money or something like that. If you take refuge in the Dharma, don't harm beings, don't harm others. And if you take refuge in the Sangha, don't rely on non-virtuous friends. So he's saying those three come from the sutra collection. Right? And then the latter three, right? Those were, if you take refuge in the Buddha, respect all images. If you take refuge in the Dharma, respect the texts and treat with respect texts of Dharma. If you take refuge in the Sangha, respect monks and nuns and the robes. He's saying those come from a text called The Six Aspects of Taking Refuge. So he's tracing all these back to sources, Sanskrit sources. Right? And you get the point there. You get why he's doing that. Okay. Then there are just two more points. So we'll finish refuge today. Okay. Next one is, this is important, but the difference between degenerating and relinquishing the precepts. And so, what this means, what is the difference, degenerating and relinquishing? Degenerating the precepts would be, if you break some of the things we've been talking about. So in other words, so the difference between degenerating, like it goes down, and actually relinquishing means you, like, you've totally given it up. Does that make sense? Actually, I'll do it in the order Lama Tsongkhapa does. So first he says, he talks about relinquishing. So relinquishing means you were Buddhist and you're no longer Buddhist. Does that make sense? Like you've stopped being Buddhist. And he's saying, he gives three ways a person might do that. He says one is a transgression of the rule not to give up your refuge even for the sake of your life, considers relinquishing. So one is if you specifically say, I give up taking refuge, right? If there's, he's giving one example. Earlier it said, don't give up the refuge even at the cost of your life or as a joke, right? So one is he's saying, if you just decide, I don't take refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha anymore. I have no interest in them. I don't have any faith in them. I don't, you know, so there is, that would obviously be, you're no longer Buddhist at that point, right? Second point he gives is embracing a teacher whose teachings are incompatible with the three jewels of refuge, right? And this one's a little subtler, so you have to be careful. This one we have to be careful of, right? This is not saying you can't, like, on the one hand, obviously, we've already said this, right? That's not saying, you know, that, what's the reason? That if you have a career and you need to study with a teacher for your career, that's fine. In other words, you can study all different kinds of things. You can study science, you can study work, you can study. But what this is saying is, in the spiritual realm, right, in the realm of your spiritual practice, if somebody makes up their own, again, and anybody has the right to make up whatever they want, but what this is saying is if somebody has come along and made up their own doctrine, and it has things in it that are totally incompatible with Buddhism, and you say, I take refuge in them, they're my spiritual guide, you know, and it's incompatible, it's not saying, like, and I just want to be clear what this means, because Dalai Lama clarified this meaning. This isn't saying that, like, again, Buddhism's open-minded in this sense. You can go to anything you want. Also, you, like, you know, if you say I'm benefiting from an aspect, Dalai Lama gives the example here of, if we gain inspiration, let's say he gives the example of, I think he gives the example of Mother Teresa. Right? Whereas if you look at Mother Teresa and you say, wow, her example of service to the poor is wonderful. I want to emulate that. That's not what this is talking about. That's wonderful. That's positive.
Would the Kadampa tradition fall into something like this?
Like the new Kadampa.
Yeah.
So it'd be something where somebody's doing, yeah, exactly. It'd be something where somebody's doing something that's totally incompatible with Buddhism. So that would be like taking refuge in a worldly spirit. That would be an example of that, right? And if you say, I'm doing that, I totally embrace that, then you're breaking the precept of refuge. Does that make sense? Or if somebody, you know, and obviously, I mean, there are obvious examples, right? If somebody were to say, I have a doctrine where harming others is, you know, part of the spiritual path, and you say, I embrace that, well, then you've contradicted the fundamental tenet of Buddhism.
What about Christianity, which has a clear belief in a God?
There also, I would say, like, you know, if somebody says, I'm gaining inspiration from Christianity, and I find it helpful, and I view, you know, I find the words of Jesus very inspiring, that's not contradicted. But if somebody says, you know, one of the basic tenets of Buddhism, for example, is all things are dependently arisen, right? So if somebody says, I believe in that would be contradictory. If somebody, in this way, if somebody were to say, so it depends on the person's mind, I guess what I'm saying. If somebody says, I find great inspiration from Christianity, I don't think that gets this. But if somebody says, I believe in the doctrine of Christianity, that the universe was created by a single being, mm-hmm. An omnipotent source, and that I was created by that, and everything was created by that, and that that being controls the universe in some sense, that would contradict a basic tenet. So it would be, I guess it depends on, to me, I'm just saying my own interpretation now, but I think the way Lama's saying, because it has to be incompatible, right? So somebody's just saying, I think Jesus, you know, I know Buddhists who say Jesus was a great bodhisattva, I take great inspiration from him. That doesn't seem contradictory. Of course, they're saying he's a bodhisattva, is already Buddhizing him or something. It seems a little funny. But if you say, that if somebody were to assert, I believe the universe was created by a solid, an omnipotent, sort of independent being, you know, who's a god, a singular, independent creature, a being, who is the creator of all, that contradicts the basic tenet of Buddhism. So that would be doing this. You know, mm-hmm. So it really depends on the person's own interpretation in a way, I think. So anything where the person sort of takes refuge in a doctrine that's fundamentally incompatible with Buddhism. Well, obviously, at that point, you can't say I'm doing this and doing that, and if they're incompatible, then it doesn't make sense.
It's like your example before about the woman.
Yeah, right. Yeah, who said, yeah, Dalai Lama's probably going, yeah, she's going to take rebirth next time, isn't it? So, Dalai Lama also gives examples like that, where he says, like, people became Buddhists, but then on their, like, as they were approaching death, their previous religion came back out or something. And he says, that's confusing. That, you know, so he's really being compassionate. He's saying, you know, if you have some very deep connection to Buddhism, then fine. But he's saying, otherwise, don't confuse yourself. And then he says, and then the last, the first one was just actively giving up refuge. The second one was embracing a totally incompatible teacher. And the third is just losing your faith, right? So saying, so not having faith in the refuges, right? So there is not, if you don't believe that the Dharma, right, the teaching, so for example, if you don't believe that the teachings on compassion and wisdom lead to are a valid refuge, right, that they lead to some kind of happiness and freedom from suffering, then that would be contradictory. If you say, I don't believe they lead to happiness, then you're not taking refuge in them, obviously. So that'd be losing faith, right, in that sense. Not faith in some, remember, the faith should be based on reason, so it's like, if your faith in the Dharma is some understanding, okay, over time, mental afflictions can decrease, and so on. That's fine.
Well, so a transgression is like if you're breaking a vow?
A mere transgression of the precepts did not cause the relief. Yeah, so what he's getting at here, in the last part there, what he's saying is, you know, if you forget to take, let's say he said, one of the precepts was take refuge 3 times in the morning and 3 times at night. What he's saying is if one night you're really tired and you forget to do your third taking of refuge, you transgressed a precept, but you didn't give up your refuge. That's not like you relinquished. Mm-hmm. He's saying that that's not good. You know, if it's an advice, it's good to follow it. But he's saying in these examples, like if you forget to take refuge, if you only take refuge 5 times one day, or if one day you get overwhelmed with anger and you hurt somebody, right? You're mean to somebody. That doesn't mean you've given up your refuge. In other words, you went against the advice of the Dharma, but you didn't relinquish it. You didn't give up refuge. You transgressed a precept in that sense. But he's saying just because of that doesn't mean you relinquished. Does that make sense? So saying everybody, you know, what he's getting at there is try not to make mistakes, but you right. will make mistakes. That doesn't mean you stop. But these three, you actually relinquished it. So he's differentiating that. Because it's an important point, right? In other words, just because, let's say, yeah, you got mad and you hurt, you know, if you got mad at your family member and you were mean to them, that doesn't mean you're not Buddhist anymore. It means you made a mistake. You should purify it, but you haven't broken, you know, like, because one of the precepts of Dharma is don't harm others. Well, you harm somebody. Okay, that's negative and you need to purify it, but that doesn't mean you've given up your practice of Buddhism. Whereas these three, you would, right? Does that make sense? So he's differentiating those. Does that make sense, Kyle? And then we'll cover the last thing just so we finish. And so then he says, taking refuge is the, so then he repeats this point, it's the great entryway to the Buddhist teachings, right? So taking refuge is the way to become Buddhist, that enters, you enter into the teachings, and that it shouldn't be just in words, but should be from the depths of your heart. And then he says, if you do that, then you will not be thwarted. So in other words, he's saying, if you take refuge in that way, internal and external obstacles won't stop you. One thing I think is interesting here is, in one way, he's saying, of course, it can decrease internal and external obstacles. Another way, actually, you could say, if you're really taking refuge, then, of course, internal, external obstacles, in one way, there are two ways to take this, I would say. This is my own reflection. One is, there won't be as many of those. But another way to take that is, there won't be obstacles for you. Whereas, because if you're practicing the Dharma, actually, then even difficult circumstances can help your Dharma practice, right? So, in other words, they don't become... They don't. You don't relate to them in the same way if you're really taking refuge, right? There are two ways to take that point, right? If you're really taking refuge in your heart, then even if some sort of obstacle arises, right? So like, there is if you, for example, an internal obstacle. Like, so if you become angry, for example, that's an inner obstacle, right? But if you're taking refuge, then that becomes a teaching where you realize, oh wow, look at my mind when I'm angry. You know, if you're not taking refuge, and you're just angry, right? You just hurt somebody. if you're taking refuge, then it becomes a teaching, where you actually look and you say, oh, I'm totally miserable when I'm angry. Everybody's miserable when they're angry. Anger is one of the afflicted emotions. No wonder it's one of the afflicted emotions. This is like showing me my own experience, the truth of the Dharma, you know, how helpful, you know. So that would be an example of, it transforms an internal obstacle. And the same with an external obstacle, right? Like, so in other words, if somebody else is mean to you, if you're not taking refuge and you just think, oh, they're a jerk and whatever, something. Whereas if you're practicing, you know, this Dharma, right, and you take refuge in the Buddha, then immediately you have to think, well, the Buddha has compassion for them, right? They're suffering. They're a suffering being. I have to develop compassion for them. So in other words, I think there are two meanings here. One is it decreases how many obstacles arise, but the other is if you really take refuge in your heart, then your experience of those obstacles changes. Does that make sense? And then it says the various qualities will come about easily, and they won't be as likely to degenerate and will increase more and more. So it's saying just by taking refuge, that simple practice, you'll progress along the path. Right? Your negative qualities will decrease and your positive qualities will increase, especially if you do it regularly 6 times a day in your heart. I use my hands to us. And the last thing he says is, he advises, you know, so when you take refuge, he's just summarizing, he's saying, so, you know, generate that sense of fear like we did earlier and faith, right? And then try to keep these precepts. Right? And so if you want to keep the precepts, you have to kind of review them sometimes. The supreme jewel, bodhicitta, where it has not arisen, may it arise and grow. Where it has arisen, may it not decrease, but increase more and more. In the snowy mountain paradise, you the source of good and happiness, all-powerful Chenrezig Tenzin Gyatso, please remain until samsara ends.